is representations which teach and delight, and which, to imitate, borrow nothing of what is hath been or shall be, but range only reigned with learned discretion into the divine consideration of what may be and should be, unquote. As we have been talking about a poet being compared to philosophers, historians, I'm just going to read out an excerpt where Sidney is talking about, as he said that a poet is something who teaches and delights, similarly he has some points to talk about the philosophers. I read out, I quote, "For conclusion I say, the philosopher teacheth, but he teacheth obscurely, so as the learned only can understand him. That is to say, he teacheth them that are already taught, but," now comes the role of the poet, "but the poet is the food for the tenderest stomachs. The poet is indeed the right popular philosopher, whose pretty allegories, stealing under the formal tales of beasts, make many more beastly than beasts begin to hear the sound of virtue from these dumb speakers," unquote. And this is the superiority of a poet compared to a philosopher. That is what has been professed. You can see the current slide where he says, "The philosophers have sole claim to our moral attention and are those primarily charged with teaching us the difference between right and wrong." Who are historians? Historians are, by virtue of their understanding of the course of human affairs, in the best position to teach virtue and virtuous actions. But Sidney has another point to make here, that who are poets? Poets are preachers. Instead, Sidney believes poets not only are the best judges for who wins this debate, but also perhaps the ones in the best position to teach us about morality and virtue. That is again a quote from the text, which talks about the role of a poet. Who is a poet? Now we are coming close to the definition of poetry. As we have talked about the charges made by Stephen Guzin and the informal kind of the presentation which I have brought, shown just a few minutes, where I have taken up the important points to be highlighted, again connecting them, reading from the main text. Now comes the definition of poetry, the kinds of poetry that is professing, and again in Sidney's own words, what are the replies to each charge, 1, 2, 3, 4, how all the four charges are individually replied by Sidney. Let's go on further. This is about how the poets are capable of using words in a manner which historians and philosophers are not able to. We can just skip on this slide. How come a poet is the right? Here I just want to talk about the types of poetries, the division that poetries are of these types given by Sidney. One is the religious kind of poetry, the other is philosophical, and the third one is the right. And in that sense, right kind of poetry, who is a right poet again? As there are charges by Guzin where a poet is attacked or has been targeted as a liar, and to that reply Sidney says that the poet is right. The category of the poets in general is to be again analyzed to say who is right and who is not. Let's read out the slide. "Thus I say, the philosopher teacheth, but he teacheth obscurely, so as the learned only can understand him. That is to say, he teacheth them that are already taught. This is the slide which I have just read out, so we can skip it. Now, again, nearer to the definition which Sydney has given, that what is poetry? Poetry is truths. Poetry for Sydney is a better vehicle for moral instruction because it so engages its audience that it allows difficult truths to be brought home. And when we talk about the aspect of this, there are many such lines from the main text which I want to read out, but I'll just take few seconds where he is talking about the world. He is talking about all literatures where poets are given importance. I'll just read out few. I quote, "In Turkey, besides their law-giving divines, they have no other writers but poets. In our neighboring country, Ireland, where truly learning got very bare, yet are their poets held in a devout reverence." Again, he's talking about Greek. He's talking about India. Every country he's telling is not without poets. And what are the reasons why poets are given such an importance? And that is what he wants to argue and present. And this is the culmination of all the points which I have read up till this. And that is, "Of all sciences," I quote Sydney's word, "I speak still of human, and according to the human conceits is our poet the monarch. For he doth not only show the way, but giveth so sweet a prospect into the way as will entice any man to enter into it," unquote. I have discussed at length what are the ideas put forth by Sydney, but just to brush up a bit, let's have an outline of the defense. What are the major areas Sydney has touched to prove this argument, or rather to give a reply to the attacks made by Stephen Guzin in the School of Abuse? Just look at the slide where I have just presented the outline of the defense. Poetry to be defended as it has come under attack. That is the first reason which made Sydney write this. Poetry has been man's first source of inspiration. All other subjects follow nature, but poetry essentially creates its own nature because the poet is a creator. And then he has given a definition of what poetry. It teaches and it moves. Poetry has a moral purpose with a destined purpose. Superiority of poetry over history and philosophy. How the poet is the supreme compared to a historian and a philosopher. More superiority. What are the reasons which make poetry the best? And the last is that poets moves men. And that is the concluding point which he makes in the essay. Let's quickly see what are the reply given to the charges made by Guzin. As we have seen, the first was not to engage ourselves in poetry. And to this, Sydney replies, he says that, I quote, "No learning is so good as that teacheth and moveth to virtue, and that none can both teach and move thereto as much as poetry." Then it is the conclusion manifest that ink and paper cannot be to more profitable purpose employed. And this is why a poet is regarded the superior ones. And this is an answer to Guzin, who says that poetry is not a form to be indulged in. And this was the reply given by Sydney. The second reply to Guzin's charges: "He who doesn't seek to establish any fact, past or present, can never lie. The poet creates something by emotion or imagination, against which no charge of lying can be brought. The question of truth or falsehood would arise only when a person insists on telling a fact. The poet does not do so." Now, this is a justification to the charge that a poet is a liar. But here Sydney gives a very clear cut And Sir Very says that the poet has nothing to do to present something. Rather, he is a creator, so he need not lie or need not give the facts of the past to the present. And then let's come to the third answer, and that is that it's the infects men, that is it rather corrupts the mind. And this is the reply, that it abuses men's wit, training it to wanton sinfulness and lustfulness love, may be partly justified, but for this a particular poet may be blamed, but not poetry. It is not poetry that abuses man's wit, but man's wit that abuses poetry. And this is, again, as I said, we started with, that is the Renaissance criticism, or the Renaissance literature was characterized as the nest of singing birds. And this is how we can relate that a poet could be tagged as a bad or a good poet, but you cannot talk about in general that all poets are not given a credit for what the form that they profess. The fourth charge, answer to the fourth charge, that a great philosopher like Plato proposed to banish the poets from his ideal republic, is also not tenable, because Plato sought to banish some bad poets of his times and not poetry itself. Plato himself believed that poetry is divinely inspired. And here again, a logical answer to what the fourth attack, the charge was made by Guzin, that even Plato was in favor of the point which I am trying to put, and that is the poets are not worthy to be read or to be given a status of or respect for the vocation that they do. Now, just quickly, we'll proceed. As I have already discussed the types of poetry, I have listed three categories: religious, then I have said philosophical, and the real. Now, this real kind has the list of these types of poetries which Sidney has introduced: the pastoral, elegy, satire, comedy, tragedy, lyric, and epic. Sidney defends each type of its in its own merit. We are in short of time, so I may not be talking about all the types which Sidney has talked about. We'll just quickly go through the characteristics of the types of poetry that he, and let's come to the definition of poetry, the most important thing which I have been telling, that Sidney says that poetry is the most ancient source of learning and wisdom. This is the thing which we have started with, that it is the first light giver to ignorance and first nurse, whose milk by little and little enabled them to feed afterwards of tougher knowledge. In a nutshell, again, a sort of a revision of what we have done, that poesy is literature, poetry, and prose. And this literature, which is a very dignified and an effective social tool, has been defended by Sidney. And here again, when he defends, his major concentration is on poetry. Poetry, as it has been the first source of human inspiration. We need not read the responses. This is the last part of the essay, where he says it is a parting curse from the defense of poesy. Perhaps some readers, I quote, "So earth creeping a mind that it cannot lift itself up to look to the sky of poetry, then I must send you in the behalf of all poets, that while you live in love and never get favor for lacking skill of a sonnet, and when you die, your memory die from the earth for want of an epith." And that is how we come to the end of the session. That is the conclusion. These are the reference and recommended books. Thank you very much and have a nice day.
Sandham, All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite na madhyam thi jodti kadi, etle
संधान